accept it. Religion doesn't say, I mean, you don't say that in the Lord's church. You say, okay, let's look at this thing. You talk about evolution. You talk about evolution. There are people in America and throughout the world that are absolutely opposed to any discussion of evolution. They will tell you that evolution is from the devil. It's not true. What did I personally ever get out of evolution? One simple thing. That we are connected to the animals that were created by God. And how do I believe that? Why do I say that? Why do we know that? Because the human embryo goes through stages in its development. Stages that it looks like a reptile, looks like a fish, looks like a bird. Okay? So we are connected, and therefore that reinforces my understanding, my appreciation of animals. But evolution comes up short. We get to all of the parts, we get to the apes and whatever they are, and then come to me. And they say, well, that's the missing link. That's where the evolution up to man falls apart. And let me even say, let's just give you the benefit of the doubt. Let's say that the animals evolved into people. Let's give them that. Where did the soul come from? I just buried my pillow. I love that dog. The dog did not have a soul. He had a spirit. Everything had a spirit. The dog did not have a soul. So even if the lower forms evolved into the higher forms, God breathed that soul into mankind. That is why people are rational and animals are not. Animals operate through instinct. People are able to rationalize. That's why we run the world. Because we can think, we can rationalize. So even if they evolve, I don't care. And I've always said this, first and best. You know, I know all these guys said in the beginning. I don't care whether it took 6 days, 6 nanoseconds, 6 million years. I don't care. I know that God is the origin, and God is the creator of our life. So faithlessness work to destroy your faith, and people will pervert science to ridicule the knowledge of God. And some people are weak. Oh, I don't want them to think I'm stupid. I don't want them to think that I'm not cool. You know what, my friends? I'm sorry to speak about myself, but I've got a pretty good education. I went all the way, did the whole level of it. And since I got out of school, I've learned a lot of things, and in all that stuff, because I believe in God, because I have a knowledge of something beyond science. Science limits itself. Faith is limitless. That is why the Greeks took to Christianity so well. All the great philosophers of the ancient world, they were Greek. Plato, Aristotle, Socrates, they were all Greeks. Cadmus, you see over here in the icon of Pentecost, shows that he is being subdued by the truth of Jesus Christ. But the Greeks could only go so far. They came to an omega point. They could not understand beyond that. They were stopped. And then when Christianity came to the Greeks, they said, wow, the omega point is gone. There was no stopping us. There was a fullness. And that's why the theology of the Orthodox Church mostly is Greek in origin. That Hellenic mentality of always looking for. The Greeks did not look at Christianity the way the Romans did. The Romans looked at Christianity the way they looked at paganism. That's why they adopted paganism. That's why they took the Greek gods and gave them Latin names. They were the same gods. The Romans looked at religion as a means of controlling and uniting a vast empire. The Greeks did not. So the Romans were not interested in going deeper. They just wanted to control the people and unite them. But the Greeks wanted to go further, and that is why Christianity has knowledge and truth that science does not have, because science refuses to go anything beyond its standards, which absolutely limit it. Go on, it says in verse 18, and Jesus rebuked him, the demon came out of him, and the boy was cured instantly. Yeshua v'charasha v'mu ashaytanu, v'shufiya v'gulamu v'indilke al-sa'ati. To rebuke is to reject. And to reject Satan and his workers and their actions. I told you I was at a memorial service this week. Man came up to me. He said, hi, Papa, I love when you do this thing. I'm not that intelligent. He said, "Do you remember me?" I said, "And at that point," he said, "I saw you 20 years ago at the funeral of the grandfather of this girl." Still didn't think it's great. I mean, come on, 20 years, give me a break. I see him one time, 20 years. He said, "I'm David." I said, "Hi, David." He said, "I'm Jewish." I said, "Okay." I said, "Well, you know, before I could finish my statement," he said, "we all believe in the same God." I said, "No, we don't. No, we don't, David. We don't believe in the same God." Now see, a lot of you are very concerned about being politically correct. There are many things I can be accused of, but worrying about being politically correct is not one of them. What I'm concerned about is not hurting people's feelings, but as far as being politically correct, when you've got to say something, say it. So I said to this guy, he said, "What do you mean I'm going to say about it?" I said, "I believe in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." "Who do you believe in?" He said, "God Almighty." I said, "That's very polite. That's very, you know, Lord." He said, "Well, I don't know." I said, "Well, would you say that you believe in God the Father?" He said, "Okay." I said, "Well, what happened to the Son and the Holy Spirit?" It's Adam. It's Allah. I said, "Well, the Lord of this world, isn't it?" Adam. Yesterday I saw people, I know these people very well, these two generations sitting usually about once a week, they're Muslims. And they said to me, "Well, we believe that Jesus was a great prophet." I said, "And?" They said, "And what?" I said, "And?" What else do you think of Nebi? Jesus Nebi. I said, "He's more than a Nebi." So this guy said to me, "Well, the Jews, they don't believe there was a Jesus." I said, "Yes, they do. The Jews believe there was a Jesus. There was a historical person named Jesus from Nazareth. Okay, they don't believe he was a Messiah. But I don't tell you what they believe, because that would be insulting to give up. The fact happens to be that someone, and they heard my son John, who was at a pretty good conversation. I said, "You know what, David? Most of the Jewish people that I know, they're not really brilliant when it comes to religion." He said, "What?" I said, "Jesus Christ is the fulfillment of the law. Jesus Christ is the fulfillment of the dispensation of God. Jesus Christ is what Judaism, the Hebrews, whatever you want to call it, they were aiming for all those years. They were looking, but they didn't know they were looking. I said, what were you looking for?" I don't say why you didn't accept Jesus Christ. He said, "Why?" I said, "Because you're looking for something military to come in and kick the Romans out and get back to the temple. Something always earthly. You are not looking beyond your noses." So sometimes you're given the opportunity to stand up and make a statement. But my son there reminds me, back in 1989, I took a trip with his mother and his brother Douglas. We went to, wanted to get to Lebanon, but we had to go through Turkey. So we flew to Istanbul. And then we were going to fly to Damascus, no story. It is against the law in Turkey for any clergyman to dress as a clergyman except the patriarch of Constantinople. Did you know that? You can meet archbishops, metropolitans in Istanbul around Turkey wearing suits and ties. It is against the law to wear a collar or anything that indicates you are a clergyman, especially Christian clergyman. And I was on the plane, I don't know if my son remembers, he's got a great memory, and I started to take my collar out, and I thought, "Well, you know what? Idiot believe that chair, you know." So I left the collar in. So sometimes you're given an opportunity to make a statement, to be a witness. Sometimes you're given the opportunity to straighten people out. Stop worrying about being politically correct. The government is not politically correct in America today. You got it? The government is not politically correct. So political correctness is not what we should be aiming for. What we should be aiming for is that we review when the demons come and they come upon us constantly. The Bible says in verse 21, "But this kind never comes out except by prayer and by fasting." Fasting without prayer is a useless action. Just recently, about a month or so ago, before I went on my annual vacation, thank God, we were in the middle of the Apostles' Fast, and one of my people who are feeling about it because it's the apostles' fast. And they said, what? Another fast? For what? That's a good question. It's an answer. I said, well, we're honoring the apostles. They went, what? Don't keep fasts. And we're coming to the end of the Domitian fast. Please do not keep fasts. It's a word that was just an anime. Okay? Don't keep the fast in spite of yourself. Don't keep the fast because of legalism. Oh, I have the fast. Because when you keep a fast that way, it's for nothing. But when you fast, if you're going to properly fast, couple it with prayer. Because he says, if this time only comes out by prayer and fasting, that tells me that prayer reinforces the fasting, and fasting makes the prayer more powerful. So when you fast, don't be, I can tell, I don't see many people that are shopping that much anymore. But don't be one of the people in the supermarket, Publix, Winn-Dixie, Walmart, Aldi, whatever. Don't be one of the people that's going and reading labels. And then doing this, because you saw the word away. It is more important for you to fast from anger, from attacking people, from judging people, from gossiping people. Fast from that. Fast from that. Fast from the times when you will be loving and you'll not be loving. Be more loving. My cousin Kenny's son, Andrew, I spoke to him recently. He said, Father John, I'm just trying to do what the Lord wants me to do, and I'm struggling to learn. I'm reading lots of parts in the Bible. I said, Andrew, I'm going to make it simple. Just be loving. I tell you that. You want to know how to be a good Christian? You want to be how to be closer to the Lord? You want to get that fulfillment? Just be loving. In the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us pray to the Lord. The blessing of the Lord is mercy and pardon and his grace and love towards man, always now and in the age of ages. Glory to the Christ above the glory to be.
When we die, parents, listen up.
When we die and we stand before God, God will ask us, what did you do with your children? And most of you will answer, I educated them. I took them to all the things they need to go to the sports activities, the extracurricular activities. They learned music, they learned this, they learned that. Help them get started in business. You know what God will ask that parent? What did you do with the child that I gave you? Did you bring him to know me? God doesn't really care about your word or living. He cares about your mind to him. And these children are going to go to school. Today, going to school is much